How to Train Your Dragon 3, The Hidden World.
The original came out in 2010, yeah. So this is a 9-year trilogy we finally got to see. And what I love about this film is the fact that it was always a very high quality, great storytelling. The fact that we got to see a modern trilogy done well, which we don't get too much these days. The great thing is it was done by a creative team where they, you know, same guy co-wrote, you know, the first one, Dean DuBlois, co-wrote, co-directed, and then he wrote and directed the following two.
Yeah.
So that was great to see, like, this, you know, unified vision across, and to have three films, each one beginning, middle, and end, and as a whole, beginning, middle, end.
So often these animated films, by the time they get to a sequel, they're passed off to a different director because the studio doesn't need to pay whoever came up with the original idea and keep it going. They'll just cash in with some, you know, workman-like director. So it is nice to see this vision through three films, same director, writer. You know, I don't know if he had this planned as a trilogy from the beginning or if it was a success off that first film.
Said
and
he
they
did.
Decided. With the second film, it does feel like it really has a great continuation off of the first. I feel like this third film is a little bit more of a tacked-on storyline to what we got from the first two films, but it was still really enjoyable for me.
Yeah.
I think it's, and I'm going to talk a lot about the trilogy because it's the closing chapter of the trilogy. And how did that work as an individual movie, and how did it work as a trilogy closer? But I think that there's a lot of things going on in this movie that are kind of not mediocre plot points, but sort of not, they're kind of being called lackluster plot points. And I think that's because your first movie is your coming of age story. Boy meets his dog, you fall in love with the characters, and it's more of an internal story within Burke where there's no real villain. It's just like these people's perception versus these people. The second one is The Empire Strikes Back. They're a few years older, it gets a little darker, it gets a little heavier stakes. You have the biggest menacing villain, in my opinion, of the trilogy.
Definitely.
And then the third one, because people are saying the villain's not that great, because the villain isn't all that important. The villain's there to help give us this closure to the story that's going on. It's my favorite movie of the year so far, but this year is very, very young. I think it's my favorite animated franchise ever, like, to me. Like, I love these freaking movies so much. I was a mess the last 5 minutes of this movie. Jacked up mess. It took my nephews to see this, and they're like, Uncle Ben, what the hell is wrong with you? I was like, get away from me!
I went to go see it 3 weeks early when they had the early screening. There was definitely people crying in my theater.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Claps, cheers, crying at the end.
Soulless, if you're not.
Yeah, so...
Having said that, visually, there was a couple scenes in this movie that had my jaw on the frickin' floor. I don't know about you guys. What'd you think about how great DreamWorks just frickin' renders these movies?
I think this franchise in particular has always been one of their pinnacle for the artists, because the art, you can tell how much care and passion the artists that work on these particular films have, because the environments are always gorgeous. All the flight scenes feel like I'm actually there, short of a fan blowing in my face to add a little bit more realism.
It doesn't feel weightless, the way they kind of...
Yeah, you feel the weight of the air, like the dragons and, you know, like Hiccup riding on Toothless, soaring through the sky, the vistas of all the clouds and scenery. I mean, it's just beautiful, beautiful animation and scenery. Man.
Across all three films, it's always been beautiful animation, probably some of the best that DreamWorks has put out or spent their time on. I even noticed in the credits that Roger Deakins has a consulting credit.
Yeah,
he's not the
that.
DP or the animation DP, whatever that would be. He's been involved with the series all the way from the beginning.
Mm.
And it really shows. I mean, there are striking images, as you would see in a Roger Deakins lit film. The flight sequences, as you said, stand out in every film. Even this third one, it hasn't gotten old. They keep them fresh, interesting, exciting. That exhilaration that you would feel if you were really riding a dragon, I mean, it really comes through the screen in every single film. Some of the most beautiful animation in years that we've seen. Almost a film that maybe I would have enjoyed in 3D, because I think there's some
at
fun
least
sequences
some of it, yeah.
there. This film looks great. Definitely one of the standouts for me is how beautiful this movie looks.
Yeah, and the sound design adds so much to that, especially the flight stuff. There's a scene in this where Toothless has sort of a love interest, and he's trying to kind of court her, and he's drawing in the sand and playing in the sand, and that sand is so freaking awesome looking. Like, it's so detailed, the sound and the movement. I mean, the whole thing is, we're just gushing.
And I love how that's a nod back to the first film with Hiccup drawing and then Toothless picking it up.
And it almost looks like the same area,
Well, they even do that in the second film as well. The mother draws something for him and Toothless comes in and does that. So
I love seeing
all
that.
Throughout. The characters have grown from film to film. I think they've done a really good job of letting these characters, and not just your leads, but your side characters, grow a bit in each film and still seem relevant and interesting. I thought it was kind of interesting that one of the side characters that gets a little bit bigger role in this one was the one that used to be voiced by T.J. Miller.
I know.
And now that he's not, for Me Too reasons or whatever.
They got this low-rent guy.
Why do they have him have more lines than, like, give that to Jonah Hill, give that to one of the other characters that's still being played by the same actor?
What was it, like, Tweedledee and Tweedledum?
I thought the mother was a little bit sidelined in this
film. Yeah, for sure.
But she stepped out a bit more because she was really... it was great to introduce that character and what it meant to the second film.
I agree.
Could have done more with her in the third film.
The way all three of them are written, where there's a sole focus for each one of them, she was the sole focus of the second one, and she's there in this one. She has a couple of things, but I agree with you. She was kind of underused, but that wasn't the story they were telling. She's kind of there now. Their relationship's solid, and it was more like the Toothless. And
but that scene where the two dragons are courting each other, that's one of the best scenes of the movie.
Yeah.
Super entertaining, super funny, but really touching, and I think... each film, at least the second and third, and even stuff in the first one with Hiccup and Astrid, I think is her name,
yes. Yeah.
Their relationship blossoming, they've always done a good job of presenting romance in these films. I've always been interested in the romance element of each of these films, when normally with these kind of animated kids movies, that's one of the last things you care about is the forced.
Yeah.
The second film has beautiful moments between Stoic and the mother character, the wife.
Yeah.
I don't remember her name. No. They introduce her. They're like, oh, by the way, I have a name and nobody knows it.
That was remember our secret tickle spot?
The relationship that you get to see between the two dragons, this one is just as entertaining,
as
beautiful to watch grow.
Beautiful. And I love how they took inspiration from the real world. Like, what Toothless was doing was based on things like Birds of Paradise, what they do, because, you know, his design is also based on dog and cat behaviors. Like, they've specifically listed things like jaguars.
Everything, like mannerisms, everything, I want to stay on that scene for a second, because that's a long scene, and people were just glued to
the
screen.
Yeah.
Because that's like a showcase of how amazing animation can be, where no one's talking for 7-8 minutes, and you're just showing how engaging the animation is and how these characters are just... It's no dialogue. It's just two amazing characters that you fully understand and what they're doing. Yeah,
typically the best kind of filmmaking is just visual storytelling, visual character development without speaking a word.
With an objective, critical eye, I do want to mention a few flaws.
Yeah,
about it. Yes.
A few flaws this movie might have.
So for the first one, I'll start. I got my little sheet here. So the villain. One thing I would have liked to have seen a little bit more with the villain, which I think would have made him interesting, is in the story you learn that he and Hiccup had a sort of parallel moment when they were younger, right? The decision, like Hiccup did one thing, and Grimmel was in the same situation, but he did the opposite. And I would have loved to have seen like them just kind of clash, like philosophy-wise, and like their worldview on that, because it totally took them down like opposite paths. And then, you know, here they are clashing.
Giving him any kind of backstory would have helped, I think.
Yeah.
That is my issue with the film as well.
No more, right?
The second film has such a great villain. Even though he's introduced very late in that second film.
He's fucking scary in that
really
one.
He's really scary
the
in that movie.
Kids are scared of that
yeah.
villain.
And this one, he's just a little bit too much of a mustache-twirling, typical villain with no backstory.
That's Mary Abraham.
Say he's out to kill all Night Furies, and there's one he hasn't got. And that's it. It ends with... that's his backstory.
Yeah.
And it's just... it's so paper thin, so weak.
I would have wanted the main decision in the movie was, you know, the dragons all have to leave. I would have wanted there to be a bit more weight to it, because I felt the weight wasn't there.
I love that final scene, the one you guys are talking about, that's so sentimental, that had you guys in tears. It didn't have me necessarily in tears, but just as being, I know, Ben, you're going to totally connect to this, but as being a pet owner, pet lover.
That's all I was thinking about.
Yeah. I'm sure that's why that was a very emotional scene for you, especially at this time. But yeah, all throughout the whole series, the way that it's played, you don't want to just call Toothless a pet. He's not just his pet.
Oh,
they are
no.
also a friend. Yeah. They're friend. As being a pet owner who knows that your pet is also your friend, man's best friend sometimes when you're talking to dog, this series all throughout, especially the culmination in this final film, has always presented that relationship of being a lover of your family, your furry family.
Yeah. Never not connected with their relationship and their friendship. Every one of those movies, it gives you chills when you see how realized they are of a pair, and it works so freaking good.
And it did get me emotionally, the decision that he makes.
Get me emotional right now.
The decision he makes during the final action scene did kind of hit me emotionally the way they play that scene.
Yeah. And I think kudos to the writers, and especially like the voice actors and the animators, for bringing it all together.
And Jay Baruchel says he never wants any credit for these movies because he goes in there for 3 days and goes, "This way, Bob!" You know, he goes in there for 3 days and shoots these things. So it's the animators and the writing, like the facial expressions of everyone. That's what got me so hard at the end. Not even the final tag scene was incredible, and it was hopeful and beautiful, but the other scene right before that was the more devastating one to watch, because it was like, you know, you knew this was coming. You knew it was coming. That was why this movie needed to be made, and that's why I don't care that the villain was weak, because that in the end is not what this movie was about.
Yeah.
It was just another plot device to kind of move it to where it needed to go. But I get that the villain was, no arguments for me that it was kind of a weak mustache twirling villain. Please don't Toy Story this fucking franchise and feel the need to throw another one in there for some money. This thing is so goddamn wrapped
it's
up.
It's done. It's done. This trilogy.
We don't
done.
Know what Toy Story 4
has
to hold.
I don't want to see it. I don't give a shit. I'm not giving any more money to Toy Story. Frickin' sex toys story.
So I really enjoyed this film. I love the fact that we have a great, as mentioned before, a great modern day trilogy, you know, that should be the standard for all films, you know. And despite a few flaws, this is still something that I enjoyed my time in the theater. I will absolutely buy it when it comes out. I will totally rewatch it in the future, both individually and, you know, all three movies when I'm in the mood. So the minor criticism does knock it down a little bit, but I still give it a very solid 9. And if you haven't seen it, please go see this film and the trilogy.
Woo! I'm not as big of a fan of the trilogy overall as I think you guys are going into this. I think you guys, you know, this was one of Ben's most anticipated films in the year to some degree. But I really enjoyed it. It turned out to be a great culmination for this story and all these characters. It still looks beautiful. The flight sequences still stand out as amazing and awe-inspiring at times. I consider this movie to be a really solid animated film in terms of its storytelling and character development, so I'm going to give this a 7.
I've already talked about the way I feel about this franchise. It's this one's even like, with things going on in my life right now, this movie was everything I needed to warm my heart, to like just give me that great creativity that's awe-inspiring. There's jaw-dropping visual effects in this movie. I love the relationship so much. Like, I dare you to try to find two characters that are so well built in three movies that give you that sense of love. And it's just a great piece of cinema. These three movies. This is such great, perfect closure, and I'm so happy. This is one of those franchises of animation that really got me to go see these kind of movies in the theater. I've seen all three of them in the theater, and for me, before we started doing the show, I didn't really watch animation in the theater that often, but these ones just had me from the very first film. And it was great to see this one, great to see this closure. I love these movies. I give this 8.5 gulps. Until next time, this is Ben.
This is Mark.
This is John.
We drink your cinema.
I drink it up.